You brought up the issue of obstacles and also health issues. Mm-hmm. And I don't even know how to articulate it. I mean, once you've got the buy-in about the worldview or the revealed truth of multiple lifetimes, it seems to ascribe a cosmic justice to virtually everything.
A moral fabric of the universe itself.
Yeah. As opposed, in my own mind, it seems to be this real projection from a dynamic of human life. Mm-hmm. You know, in other words, it really, I don't think it would really apply to, you know, like say lions and antelopes, mm-hmm. you know, the same interpersonal dynamic and mores and what governs human life, to being, a moral fabric of the universe, such that it's like, oh, okay, so that cancer you've got, or that muscular dystrophy, or whatever, you know, it's not just...
it's not just molecules, it's karma.
Yeah, it's payback of some sort.
It's. I wouldn't quite use that word. I also wouldn't use the word retribution. It is, if you...
Consequence.
It's a consequence. That would be certainly a Buddhist term. It would be rather like you're trying to spray all the bugs to get them off your orange grove upstream. The DDT flows into the river, and the fish eat it, and you wind up catching the fish, and you eat the fish, and you get sick. Is it payback? Is it retribution? Is it nature pounding you over the head? Well, it's just consequence. You put some contamination in nature, and you're sowing as you reaped, or you're reaping as you sowed. So that theme of as you sow, so shall you reap, that's from the New Testament, mm-hmm. Buddhist notion of karma. I mean, if I had not gone into Buddhism, my career was going to be in environmental studies. And that's about, among all the sciences, that's about as close to Dharma as you get. Because there's this cause and effect, which sometimes takes generations to circle around. And there it is, and it winds up being inconducive to your flourishing. There's nothing intrinsically evil about DDT. You just don't want it in your body, or you don't want it in the water, or the air, or the soil, if what you want to do is live and procreate and live a happy life. So there's nothing intrinsically evil about spreading DDT all over the planet, assuming you don't really care about life. But if you do, then this is a really bad idea. But when I look at the issue of karma, which I do take very seriously in the Buddhist context, I don't take it so much as a religious issue, which is a very easy way to do it. And I certainly don't take reincarnation as a religious issue. As I said, I was preparing for a career in science from the time I was 13 until I was 20. And I've done a lot of work in science since then and done a lot of collaboration. I'm working on 4 research projects right now with scientists. So this is very much part of my life. And I'm perfectly aware of and have no problem with most people, many, many people, taking these things as a revealed truth, basically like as if it came from the Bible. The Christians believe in Genesis and blah, 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 and the Buddhists believe in reincarnation and karma, and these are religious statements. That's the easy conclusion. It's not my conclusion. And that is, I look at the issue of the nature of consciousness and ask, first of all, what do we really know in terms of science? Because I have a lot of reliance on science. What do we really know about the necessary and sufficient causes for the emergence of consciousness? Well, precious little. We don't know. I mean, we don't know. There are a lot of assumptions.
How we went from like two-cell amoebas to
how any creature in the whole of evolution, how was it that any creature actually became conscious, and what, as opposed to simply reacting to the environment, like iron filings due to a magnet. Like coral does to its environment. I mean, I don't believe that plants are conscious. They may be, but if they have to, they have to demonstrate it to me. But plants respond to their environment. That doesn't mean they're conscious. I mean, scientists don't believe they're conscious. I don't believe their consciousness, but they certainly respond to their environment. The blossoms open when the sun comes up and so forth. And so there are all types of responses to environment that obviously don't require consciousness, or at least there's no reason to believe they require consciousness. At some point in evolution, there were some multicellular organisms, maybe the most primitive ones like hydras that have the most primitive nervous system, that became conscious. I mean, somewhere along, we're conscious. We're presuming that 5 billion years ago or 10 billion years ago, there were no living organisms that were conscious because the universe was too hostile a place for that. So somehow out of this development of evolution, consciousness emerged. But how it emerged, nobody really knows. And the current theory of evolution does not account for it. It's a myth to believe it does. But likewise, neuroscience does not account for the emergence of consciousness. It's looking with great intelligence and sophistication on the neural correlates of conscious states, but how is it that consciousness actually emerges? Well, the answer is we don't know. And so there's not much competition, frankly, in terms of scientific knowledge. There's an enormous amount of competition from scientific assumptions that the mind consciousness is nothing more than a function or property of the brain. That may be true, but that's not a scientific conclusion. It's a metaphysical assumption. And so Buddhism at this point doesn't have any competition because we don't know scientifically or in terms of evolution or neuroscience, either one. So questions of the origins of consciousness. Buddhism has a theory that is, I would say, internally very coherent. And that is, I'm 54 years old, so 56 years ago I didn't exist. I'm including time in the womb. 56 years ago, there was no creature in the universe called Alan Wallace. This guy, who's a male, American, did not exist anywhere at all. And so sometime between, let's say, 56 years ago and now, at some point, I was conscious for the first time, this individual. What were the origins of that consciousness? And it may be purely a byproduct of the brain, but that is yet to be demonstrated. It's not a scientific conclusion yet. The Buddhists say that the brain, the body, conditions consciousness, but it's not the actual source of consciousness. That my current male American stream of consciousness, conditioned by my brain, upbringing, biology, diet, and so forth, this consciousness actually emerged from a prior stream of consciousness that preceded this lifetime, that manifested over a sequence of earlier lifetimes in different psyches, male, female, human, non-human, but each time conditioned by brain. And then eventually my psyche, Alan Wallace's psyche, will be terminated, but it will withdraw back into this substrate, a continuum of consciousness, that will manifest in another psyche. So there's one theory. Well, that theory actually is completely congruent with what we know about the brain. And my brain, there's nothing that violates it from any scientific knowledge that we have. But then the scientist can say, where's the evidence? And the Buddhist would say, well, you're not going to get any evidence by studying the brain. That gives you access only to the material substrate. You're not going to get any access to anything beyond that. And likewise, for all of behavioral psychology, you're not going to get it there either. You're looking at the outer manifestation. The only way you could possibly tap into this deeper substrate of consciousness that carries on from lifetime to lifetime is not by looking outwards, but by looking inwards and tapping into very deep states of samadhi that go deeper than the level of your psyche, your male psyche, your American psyche, into the substrate out of which that arises. Tap into that, and then you have some possibility of putting this Buddhist hypothesis to the test. Well, thousands and thousands of yogis have done that, and they report that when you tap into that substrate, you can tap not only into memories earlier in this life, you can actually tap into veridical memories in past lives, which then can be corroborated by third-person tests. And then in exceptional cases, tests, that is, you go into deep samadhi, and they suddenly, oh, I was a Lhasa Apso, and my owners were such and such, you know, whatever, and find out, okay, well, tell me about your dog, you know. I mean, this would be a bit odd. Let's make it a human being. But okay, I was a little kid in Lhasa, let's say, you know, all right, and then I lived out my life as a shopkeeper in Lhasa and died in 1949, maybe, you know. Well, let's imagine, now this is entirely hypothetical, but I went into deep samadhi, and suddenly I'm having these, and I'm tapping into memories, going deeper, deeper, deeper from this state of samadhi. I go back to the womb, back prior to the womb, and then I'm remembering how I died. And I'm remembering who my wife was and the kind of shop I had. And who are my business partners, and who did I sell to, and did I know, and blah, 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 blah. Well, if I can tap into memories for which Alan Wallace in this lifetime has no conceivable way of getting that information, and these memories can be corroborated by other people who are living at that time, people much older, people in their 80s who lived in Lhasa at that time, then that would count not as a religious belief, but as empirical evidence. Well, of course, there are hundreds of Tibetan tulkus, incarnate Tibetan lamas who are identified as children, who ostensibly or reputedly achieved such a state of realization they were able to direct their consciousness into the next lifetime, retain memories from past life, and so when they're being interrogated as small children, they're recognizing people, calling them by name, picking out their own personal possessions, and then showing a great facility for relearning what they had known in the past life. It's gotten a little bit fuzzy by getting a new body. And so this is something that actually can be studied. I'm saying this is not as propaganda or as dogma or as, now you got to believe me because I said so. But it's something that actually can be studied. And it can be studied by means of Ian Stevenson's work at the University of Virginia, who spent 40 years combing the globe for children who allegedly have past life memories, testing them, see if they have any, whether their accounts are sound, valid, whether they have any access to that information in this lifetime. It's 40 years of good research. It should be looked at because it's a scientific issue, an empirical issue, and not just received wisdom or revealed wisdom or religious authority and so forth. So now it's just going to move quickly. And just imagine that one does extremely careful research in this area, both contemplatively as well as anthropologically, you know, in interviewing children, and then doing a real tukul study. How about that one? Of doing a whole long research, 10, 20 years of research on tulkus, and being with the search parties, and see how they find the tulkus, see how they interrogate them, see whether it's hocus pocus, like, oh, he chose, you know. I mean, this is not a double-blind experiment, but is it being done with integrity? Or are people fudging here? You know, how much integrity is there? And when they come to a confidence, this is the incarnation of such and such, is there any reason anybody else should believe that? Or is this purely a belief within a religious community, you know, an in-club, but it's not compelling to anybody else? Well, what's the scoop? That would be an interesting research project. It hasn't been done. But let's now just jump ahead. And let's imagine in 20, 30, 40 years, we've had a number of yogis go into this and really investigate it, and it's been studied, and now just purely hypothetically, let's imagine the data become really compelling. It looks like there really is individual continuity of experience, and people can retrieve memories from past lives. And moreover, the degree of the kind of qualities they cultivate, compassion, wisdom, whatever they may be, actually carry over. And this Buddhist spiel of being able to develop spiritually from lifetime to lifetime actually winds up being true, that there's really good evidence for it. This is conceivable. It would take a lot of research and a lot of open-mindedness, and maybe it will wind up being totally not validated. But let's imagine it is. So that's purely a thought experiment. And let's imagine in 40 years or so, it looks like any reasonable person looking at the data would say, that's not a religious truth, that's empirical, that's an empirical truth. That's like gravity, I mean, it works, it's an inverse square law, I mean, there's no big belief system about it at all. The results are really compelling, and this old superstition that the mind is just in a function of the brain just is wiped out by the data. Now one raises another question, and that is, if we have that kind of continuity from lifetime to lifetime, so here I am as a relatively affluent American, just because I'm relatively affluent compared to Bolivians, and with my life, and with this degree of spiritual maturation and also limitations, is there going to be any coherence between the quality of my life now and the quality of my life in the future, the qualities that I cultivate, qualities I'll be imbued with in the future, the kind of connections I have with teachers and so forth, any relationship, or is it going to be a complete crapshoot of just, you know, random chaos? If one takes this seriously, this notion of continuity of consciousness, not as an article of religious belief, but as possibly a facet of reality that can be tested empirically, then this becomes a pretty pressing question. And that is, I'm going to die. I'm going to have continuity. Death will not entail termination, even if I wanted it to. I'm going to have a new body. Is this a crapshoot? I mean, totally random, that is utterly irrelevant what I do now and what I'll experience later? Or is there a coherence? Are there patterns in this continuity of experience? Is there coherence or is it random? That strikes me as if one takes this continuity of consciousness business seriously, this becomes pretty important, crucially important. And it's going to life transforming. If it's a crapshoot, then party, whatever. I mean, it's a very different world. It says, you know, it's not up to me anyway. I mean, that poor schmuck that has my stream of consciousness next time, it's completely a crapshoot. So whatever I do now is completely irrelevant to what he experiences.
You think that's a fair either or?
I beg your pardon?
You think that's a fair either or? I mean, in other words, that like within my own limited worldview, I can see that there are cause-effect relationships that either conducive or deleterious. So, you know, my personal happiness, sure. You know, within limited time, within very limited time mm-hmm. ranges, you know, not, it doesn't require the multi-lifetime.
Right.
You know, so, sure. Yeah, I mean, you know, a few years of Mick Jagger's lifestyle, you know.
That, yeah.
We can see it would have its pluses, but. But you know, there's flip sides to it. You know, and I don't think you have to go to like, well, yeah, you know what that's going to do to you in, you know, 15 lifetimes from now.
Right.
It's like,
it's very true. I mean, I know a lot of materialists who I think are very ethical people. And frankly, if I suddenly stop believing, because I, on the basis of empirical evidence and reason, I do believe there's a continuity of consciousness. And out of faith in the Buddha, I believe in karma as well.
Okay.
But if I were suddenly to abandon that, if there were some overwhelming evidence that showed that this whole notion of continuity of consciousness was false, would I then become a party animal and just be a sheer hedonist? Not likely, because I just don't find it that enjoyable. You know, I'd rather live a meaningful life even without that. So, no, it's not like you're either a Buddhist and ethical, or you're a secular person and a total schmuck. I don't believe that, never have. But it, once again, if we come back to this thought experiment, just imagine for the sake of argument there's continuity, then I think you can set it up as an either-or in the sense of, is it random or is it coherent? Random or not random, that's, I mean, that's a law of the excluded middle kind of question. And if it's random, then what we do, obviously, it's a tautology. What we do in this lifetime is irrelevant to what happens in the future. And that's a possibility. Or it's also a possibility that what we do in this lifetime actually has an impact on the kind of people we'll be and the kind of circumstances we'll encounter in the future. And at this point, I say, well, I just don't have the empirical evidence. I've seen Ian Stevenson's work. I've met a lot of tulkus. And I've seen a lot of evidence that really is persuasive to me, much more than the scientific materialist shtick that it's all a function of the brain. They just have not persuaded me for a lack of evidence. And the Buddhists have a lot of evidence, and I say, you don't have much, you have a lot, I'm going to go with you. It's that. When it comes to karma, I don't have the evidence. But then I think, who's looked into this most deeply? Well, not the neuroscientists, because they really haven't looked into consciousness deeply at all, but the Buddha himself. And the night of his enlightenment, when he said, I scoped out innumerable past lives of my own, I then directly observed, he said with direct knowledge, I observed sequence of lifetimes of innumerable other sentient beings, second watch of the night. Third watch of the night, I think it was, that I noticed the patterns of relationship from lifetime to lifetime. Well, that's a lot further than I've gone, but since his practice was so had so much integrity to it, and there have been so many people that, who have replicated his type of research, I would call it research because I think that's what it is, and because they are really serious in the pursuit of truth, not in the pursuit of religious beliefs, but actually knowing reality. And we've had so many enlightened beings after him that, again, this is now an act of faith for me. It's not absolutely compelling empirical knowledge because nobody has that. At least I don't, and the scientists don't, and if the Buddhists do, they have knowledge I don't have, but I trust them, and I am inspired that I would like to seek deeper insight myself so that I can need to have less faith because I have more knowledge.